when you deal with a topic which is still evolving, still new, then there would not be unanimity, and so there will be different perspectives. So in fact, among the things that I have shared with you, the things, some of the videos that I asked you to watch, you will see a different perspective. You will see, when you say, what is semantic web, or introduce semantic web, you will find many videos out there, many slides on the slideshare, and they will all talk about different things, right? I'm going to give one such perspective, my perspective, mostly. So, and the reason we are doing that is that you will see that while we are talking about Web 3.0, there can be a lot of things in Web 3.0. We are primarily going to talk about how do you make meaningful use of information on the web. And information would be in many forms, many data forms. We talk about enterprise data, we talk about social data, sensor data, and so on and so forth, right? So the idea is that in this age of big data, massive amount of data is generated of a variety of different forms. In biological sciences, we talk about data that these machines generate, mass spectroscopy, or what are the machines, sequencing machines that we generate. Or in the context of, I got email, somebody's interested in processing large amount of neuroscience data. Or earlier, last couple of weeks ago, I was at a workshop on astrophysics, and they are generating a lot of data, right? So there are many, many types of, and their data is often this magnetosphere. The data is about some machines that measure magnetic fields. There's some machines that take very high quality, the telescopes that take images and videos and things of that nature. So broad variety of data is out there, right? The idea is here, how do you meaningfully make use of the data? So, and the thesis is, and the that semantics is what makes that possible. So that is going to be underlying theme throughout our class. So, I had this question because this was a talk originally given in 2012. What are the two most important software success stories of 2012?
Apple Siri.
Siri, yes. The another one was Watson. Watson defeating Jeopardy. Now again, there is no unique answer, but you know, my view is that these were very interesting. They are interesting in multiple different ways. And one way, and why I consider them very interesting, is that I talk about a vision I call computing for human experience. And the general idea is that all this technology is there to serve human needs. So whatever technology there is that makes it easier for humans to improve their life, improve their productivity, to me that is the most interesting thing. From that perspective, these are particularly important examples. There are many other examples that were important, but these are more important. Siri is one, like a personal agent, right? You ask a question, you give the answer, right? If you say, call mom, or schedule appointment, or things of that nature, right? And Watson, because it's cognitive computing where it analyzes massive amount of data and helps you, for example, helps a doctor make a better decision. The example I gave, I think in the last class, you might remember, or if I forgot to give the example, Watson claims that they can get 90% accuracy on the outcome of a patient, given all the data about the patient, cancer patient, compared to the 50% accuracy of the oncologist at Anderson, which is the biggest cancer institute in the United States, right? And that's a very significant statement, right? If the machine can, you know, because we are generating so much data, right? We have no longer the ability to process all the data that is being generated. One survey that was published that said that only 0.5% of all the data gets analyzed, all the data that is collected. And I have another talk on big data. Maybe I'll give that later on in this class because it also brings a lot of things together. So if machine can help you really make sense of the data, and IBM calls this cognitive computing, then indeed our lives will be easier. And what are the common technologies when you talk about this? Right? So, to some extent, there are a number of technologies, and they have some amazing, for example, progress. Not just them, but I think they have used technology from third party, whereby there is speech recognition, let's say, because in both the cases, you are a person is speaking to the computer. In the Jeopardy, you are asking a question, and the answer is coming again by human in English, right? And that is being interpreted by the system. Siri the same way. So there's a great technological advance. Anyways, I remember using some of the speech recognition technology a decade ago, and things have moved on very, very much better. In fact, one of the reasons why these technologies have moved on better is that many of them use a model, and they have done extensive training, many of them come with additional knowledge of the domain you talk about. For example, you can buy this software from a company, the name skips my mind, and the doctors use it all the time to talk, using speech. But the reason that doctors use very specialized vocabulary, right? So, for example, I would say somebody is having heart attack, and they would say this person is is suffering from myocardial infarction, right? So the terminology is very different, right? To understand that, the system is given and trained with and infused with very specific domain knowledge. That is a form of semantics, the word semantics. So semantics, in a very simple way, is meaning and use of data. Use in application. And when the system is understanding of what is the use of the data, how that data is used for something, that is what that use part is, and the meaning, the intrinsic meaning, as a human will interpret. Of course, the hard part is that human interpretation for the same thing we all come across is different. We can all take the same piece of text, and we all have a little different understanding of exact same piece of text, right? So that makes the things harder in terms of how semantics is supported. But I will come to that later on as to how, in technology sense, we are able to bring the support semantics, right, and make this technological possible. The other thing, though, is that in both of these cases, they use background knowledge or ontology. So I remember one of the last person to join the company named Siri, before Apple acquired, is a person I know very well. His name is David Martin, and he is a knowledge representation person. So he is involved in building ontologies. So clearly, some form of ontology, knowledge representation, was very critical in Siri's work, and you'll see that in this course we'll really investigate that in further detail. The same case is with Watson, where it is being trained with, the software is trained with a lot of knowledge about that particular domain, that particular topic area, okay? And that is what makes this system smarter. As I said in the last class, that brain has two fundamental components, the knowledge and reason. Right? Together we are smart, intelligent. Right? Because we have both, we are intelligent. And what is happening is that in the recent years, there is perceptible, increasing understanding by more and more of the computer scientists in different fields that indeed this background knowledge is very important. So there are other very, very successful fields of computer science, machine learning being one of them, natural language processing is another, information retrieval is another, right? in each of them, what we are seeing is that they have recognized the importance of knowledge. So there is a very, very well-known professor in machine learning. His name is Pedro Dominguez. And he has recently, well, a couple of years ago, he wrote a paper talking about machine learning, a broad paper on machine learning. And he, you know, I remember distinctly the title of the fourth section of his paper, "Data Alone is Not Enough." And basically, it says you need knowledge. Right? So these systems are infusing knowledge, and fundamentally, the semantic web and all those people working on semantics, and as I started working on semantics in late 80s, we, you know, some of us largely understood the important and powerful role of knowledge. Okay? So, just stepping up a bit here, these are just some of the technologies that were purchased. These are some of the technologies that came into mainstream. So, for example, Microsoft purchased a company called PowerSet. And what PowerSet did was, I think they purchased for about 100 million. What PowerSet did was to go through Wikipedia and extract rich factual data or knowledge, including relationships. I'll come back to that and explain the importance of that a little bit later on. Or Apple purchased Siri in 2010. And this was the title of article or something. Once again, the backstory is about semantic web. Then Google buys MetaWeb. And this is the company that where there are a bunch of, a few people actually, very small company. I know the founder of this company. They basically created this freebase. And they created it manually. And what happens here is that Google has started to, started with that as a base, and Google is good at scaling. But manually creation of knowledge cannot scale too well. So Google started to, add more, started to apply machine learning techniques largely to extract more and more facts and add to this to make what is called as Google Knowledge Graph. And this is 2012 thing, where I said Google Knowledge Graph could change the search forever. And you have access to this slide presentation, right? So you can, this is a link, click on that and see that article. By the way, I do expect that you will do that on your own, a lot of it, right? So this class is not just about coming to class and listening and feeling good about it or whatever. It's about really exploring on your own. So, and voila, you will see that indeed, a lot has changed in 2 years with Google search. A lot. Okay? And much of it is thanks to this Google Knowledge Graph. Okay? And in a couple of weeks, I'll share with you how we had in my company when I started in 1999 something very similar to Google Knowledge Graph. We call it World Model, and we also call it Ontology. The way we built it is different, but the role of that is very similar, or it's probably the same in a way. We had built a semantic search engine there. And in Google, when you search, for example, name of a famous person or well-known person, you see on the right-hand side, something comes up, right? Well, we had that too. I don't know what exactly Google calls it. We called it Rich Media Object. That object was created from the knowledge base. Okay? So, and then Facebook has this open graph, exploitation of graph. That is very critical. Graph is a very critical technology in semantics and semantic web. And Twitter has annotation capability, or had annotation capability. I don't know exactly what they have been there. So these are some of the titles of the articles that were there. Right? And yet, by the way, very interestingly, in one of the videos that I have shared with you, where people are talking about semantic web, there are some people who are presenting opposite view. So at this level of class, it is going to be important for you to be able to look at different viewpoints and make up your own view, as perhaps the third thing is correct rather than A or B, right? So, okay. The other things that were happening in this case, there is a technology RDFA adoption, but it's all about metadata or annotations to the data, and the search engines using that metadata. And what has happened is, since the time that I had this slide made, there is this big evolution called schema.org. So a number of companies, internet companies, came together to define the schema.org. And this is another thing that is starting to play a very important role in adding semantics to the search engine and many other things that are happening on the web. And in the schema.org, what is happening here is that it provides basically, just like if you have a database and you have schema for the database, there is more understanding to the software as to how to interpret the data and what certain fields of the data mean, rather than you having to guess what that means. If you have no schema, well, you don't know what the, is, and you get just a database from some third party, you don't know what that means, right? Having the schema gives you definition, right? Because data description language, where that is used for if you have a schema. Well, basically this is a particular form of lightweight ontology. We'll discuss the word ontology much later, a bit later. So with this adoption, for example, different web pages can provide certain data about the pages itself. So it is the people who have done the content, like a web page, telling the meta, giving the metadata as to what the web page is about, in a form that a search engine or web crawler and whatever gets the data from web crawler, which is the other parts of search engine, understand what that data is about, right? You have a concept, let's say Dayton as in city versus Dayton Airport as in another entity which is not Dayton City. And how do you distinguish between the two? You can do that, right? Through use of some schema like that. So let's look at a bit of history. There has been a lot of work, semantics with metadata and ontologies for heterogeneous documents and different repositories of data, including the web, in 1990s. So I had one of my students, Vipul Kashyap, my first PhD student, and I had a paper, I think in 1994, where we talked about multiple ontologies and federated environment. Federated meaning multiple semi-independent environments. Like US is a federal structure because there are some regulations at the federal level and some regulations at the state level. Right? For example, voting decisions are all made by state level. You know, federal government in Washington cannot make rules about voting things. So each state can come up with their own voting laws, right? Kind of thing. Or who can? What is necessary for identifying a voter, as an example. But anyway, we should discuss that. This was the commercial product. This is a software. This is a research that we started at Belcore that I had defined, and it then became a commercial product in 1995. So it was, we'll come back to that later on. Belcore screwed up. I was at Belcore at that time because I tried to convince them to make this as a web product, a search engine for the web, and instead they only that their business types. Could not understand that in 1993 they could not understand that there will be a market like internet market, so they only focused the company and the product to the baby bags. Otherwise this could have been a major early search product kind of thing. Then there are other projects. This was a couple of work at University of South USC, University of South California. This is our project, Observer, where we do multi-ontology query processing. So you have multiple description of the worlds, different parts of the world, and how do you do query across multiple of them? Shu is a work, I think, that related to Jim Handler, who has been well recognized as an evangelist for semantic web. He was he gave many early talks on semantic web. And there's some of the projects that I have where how do you have in basic part of the HTML is HRF, right? Who does, does everybody know, anybody does not know what is HRF? Everybody knows HRF, right? Yes. Okay. So that's a big challenge because I expect the basic semantic, sorry, basic web technologies. So let's make sure we touch upon that. But you have to, you know, it will be very hard if you don't have the core of the web technologies with you. So HRF is hypertext link, pointing a link to something else, right? Now, when I take a document and I say HRF and I give a link, right? The browser, in the browser, that document will be rendered and you'll see underline or blue text or whatever, another way, right, of highlight. But you don't know exactly what that document is about or whatever that link takes you to. You don't know very well. Only thing you know is the text that is given for the link, right? The text, we call it syntax. But what if I were to add a metadata, meaning a description of some sort, right along with that text, right along with that, you know, a string that links to the for the document. So mref is, M stands for metadata. So I defined in 1996, and then there's another paper in 1998, this concept of mref. And I wish that we had done a lot more work in that area, because it was very valuable work, whereby you're making the links meaningful. Right, the meaning, you know, right? So that was the idea. So, and InfoCult was another very exciting topic. Also, I mentioned, you know, Jim Handler, for example. He was a program manager at DARPA, and he supported a big program called DARPA Agent Markup Language. And there was a similar program in Europe. And here, the people were coming from AI field, artificial intelligence. They are people coming from basically logicians, many of them. So they use description logic, which is a more desirable form of logic, and say that we'll represent the knowledge in this form, using that. So, so these are the early part of the history of the semantic web, and there's a lot more of that work. I will come to that. Then it is TBL who used the word semantic web for the first time in his 1999 book, Weaving the Web. Okay, I founded a company also in the same year, and I probably the first talk ever given on the topic of semantic web is the one I gave in 2000. So again, you can click at the link and look at my talk that I gave in 2000. And in fact, the same year we filed for a patent, which was awarded in 2001. Then came, in 2001, probably the most well-known paper on semantic web, which is by TBL, Handler, and Ora Lasila. And so, you know, everybody kind of who knows about semantic web knows about this, this paper. What is very interesting is that, of course, I have my very biased views because I've been involved in this thing from very, very early on, in fact, early 90s. So this had a lot of, because remember, there was this relationship, you know, this markup language, description logic, and other things. So this is a good dose of, the description logic kind of stuff, or knowledge representation emphasis. And another big thing here was agents, saying that the vision of semantic web that is portrayed in that article, and I very much welcome all of you to look at that article, because it is such an important piece, so that you can make up your own view, mind, as to how has semantic web come, grown, as compared to the vision portrayed here or in my patent. Right? And then you can figure out which one has actually panned out. So there's a very significant distinction. Here, for example, the idea was, and they gave example of agent helping humans or doing on doing travel planning on behalf of humans. Right? We are still waiting for that. Right? So something to keep in mind. On the other hand, the world model and ontology discussed here, and it's using improving search, browsing, advertisement, that has come to fruition. That is what semantic, you know, search of Google does right now. There are always some technological differences, but conceptually there are huge commonalities. And then first 5 years of semantic web saw a lot of AI and description logic, but now after that more practical and applied work has dominated and continues to dominate. So one of the thing is called linked open data. We'll come to know about it a little bit later on. And a few years later TBL talked about more of a focus. Well, he has actually always been more for data, so he's talking about focus on data rather than logic based things and reasoning and such. And so he came up with this data web, and that kind of, he outlined some principles and then those four principles and together made and then became part of what is a set of principles for linked open data. Then we'll come to that later on. And there's some other people who focus on reasoning and intelligent processing, and that comes in variety of forms also. Again, the form of reasoning, as in the one that you can do on description logic, inferencing, for example, I haven't seen much use of it at all. There's a very narrow use of that, particularly for example, understanding consistency of a knowledge base. But for more broader thing like search and all, there is no such, the description logic based reasoning or inferencing, for example, has no role. It doesn't scale, and many other things. It just is not powerful enough. Okay. All right. So now I'll give this extremely simple, but I hope very important introduction to semantic web. Those are historical point of view, but really what is semantic, what makes for semantic web, right? So there are three points of that. I can describe that in three ways. And again, in the point, the pointers I have given in the other, Google Doc has multiple other, links to other slides and other introductions by, there's one very good one by Manu Sporny. So look at that and compare with that, this one, and then form your opinion. So number one is some form of knowledge, right? And one, it could be in what people call ontology, and it may come with in different forms. Very weak form of taxonomy, just a taxonomy of concepts. People are organized in a hierarchy, or a bunch of vocabulary, the terms that have they've tried to do give standards meaning to some terms, or some form of conceptual model, rich data model, or some and that captures knowledge of a domain. So there are different ways you represent this knowledge, but the important thing is agreement. All that knowledge is valuable because its users, some group of people, have come to agree that this is what this knowledge means. This is what the composition of knowledge, this term means that. So, in another technical term for that is ontological commitment. It's an agreement by the people to have shared interpretation. This is a very interesting thing. Concepts by itself are, can be very nuanced. The same thing could have different interpretation by different people, right? And any level of formalization could end up, so there's some very simple concept and formalization may be perfect, and you can write in logic exactly what it means, some mathematical concepts and other things. But there are many other concepts in the real world where humans have intrinsically different interpretation. No level of formalization can make it enough. And so then you ultimately end up by human saying, yeah, we agree to that, handshake, right? Or a long textual description, that's natural language description, right? So this is a challenging issue. The point though is that whichever way you come to an agreement, right? When you don't come into agreement, what happens in the world? You have a law case, and then there is all the lawyers' interpretation, this and that, and then ultimately some ruling comes, right? And there's jury that comes to an agreement or not, right? So that's the same process that you one has to create. Now, very often, this knowledge has two components: schema, or what is called as a description or definitions, and knowledge base or description base, or facts. So I would say that a person has an affiliation with a company or employer, right? And then I would say, well, my name works for Wright Sage University, right? So that's a fact. So your schema information, the formal thing that I said, and the facts here. It is fundamentally the agreement that enables the interoperability for people to have common interpretation. The formal descriptions are welcome because that makes it for machine processability, and that is what adds to the automation. So more formal description you can have, better automation you can have. But there is a limitation to how much formalism you can do, and that would mean there is a limitation of kind of automation you can do. Now, in general, what happens here is that the semantics the semantic technology can have multiple applications. There are applications that are, for example, like search. In this particular case, the level of formalism you need is less. Why? Because the result of using the semantics, let's say for search, is ultimately interpreted by human. And human brain is extremely powerful. So human is really able to make a lot more sense, even the machine is not able to make a sense. Versus an analysis that has to be done entirely by machine, and then machine to have actually accurately interpret the data, that is very hard, that requires more formalization. And we probably be able to appreciate this later on. The second part is what is called semantic annotation or metadata. Or metadata extraction, or metadata, or labeling. I remember a very simple definition that Tim Berners-Lee gave of semantic web. He basically said, I'm rephrasing, of course, that this is about labeling the content or data, right? And let me give you a good interpretation of what he meant. I think that suppose you go to a site that allows you to store all the pictures. Right? So let's say you go to Flickr, right? And you have all the pictures there. But how is anybody else going to find your picture? The only way they're going to find your picture is by if you label your pictures, and you have to use those terms to find your picture. Right? So for example, you have taken a picture of a nice flower or a garden. Say garden or flower or whatever, right? Or you might even say rose. Now, if I search, well, how am I going to say, to the computer that I'm looking for a nice white flower, or I'm looking for a flower that happens to be, happens to have good smell? Unless I use the term like rose or whatever else, most systems are not. There are really extreme circumstances where I can create a system that you can give another picture as a exemplar, and then you can find something similar to that. But by and large, you look at any today's search engine and look for image search, you need a text, right? And so you have to have a label there, right? Now it is a label that helps you find the data. But the same general analogy happens, matters that it is, you have document and you have a text label. Now, of course, it is simple to say you have labels. Now, labels, at what level of granularity? Labeling what? Are you going to label the whole file or document? Or are you going to label each of the individual names of the each of the individual objects in the document? Like this is a person named, this is location of a city, this is location of city. of course that will vary, right? So you have to come up with what level of labeling you will do, right? Now what happens typically is that so it is the label that associates meaning with the data. Let me give one very interesting example. Suppose you label something as rose, and use and I search it by saying pink flower, right? Now, it is possible, a smart system, a semantic system, could use a knowledge that rose is a flower. And hence, even if you did not ask for rose per se, you asked for flower, I know rose is a flower, so I know that should be in your answer set. Right? This is a simple form of reasoning. Right? So, you want to, that is how that meaning was used, right? Any human brain would interpret that. Almost all of us know that rose is a flower, right? So I show you rose and say, is this a flower? You say yes. Is it easy for machine to do? No, unless it has this knowledge and ability to reason, right? So again, I come back to those two parts of it, but the point is item number one. Is that knowledge part. Item number two is to associate, label the data, annotate the data, or provide the metadata, all the same things. Right? Now, one of the interesting thing though, is that this can be done manually, semi-automatically, or automatically. Right? So, given an ontology or knowledge base of concepts that are in my world, that I am interested in, and given a document, or file, I can potentially automatically annotate so far as my annotation is limited to everything that is described in here, right, in the knowledge base. So when we had this company Tali in year 2000, we could process 1 million documents. Document would be typically a web page, like an article on CNN, per hour per machine. So these articles keep on coming, typically they would have of the order of 1,000 words, and we are a knowledge base, we will have hundreds of thousands of concepts, and we will see whether any one of them matches or not. In that process, you have to do a number of things, like you have to do stemming of the words and all kinds of text processing you have to do to be able to work. It's not exact match. Right? More recently, a couple of years ago, we created a knowledge base for something called human performance and cognition. So this is a topic of interest to Air Force Research Lab. They were our sponsors. They funded our research. And then what we did is to take all the abstracts on PubMed. There are about 20 million or so, and annotated them using this ontology. The ontology, quote unquote, or knowledge base had 2 million concepts and 3 million relationships, labor, right? So, Alan, Smith, wrote this program to go through all of these things. It is a program, and then highly scalable, and then we did all the, found all those spotting, and then indexed them. Now, this is an interesting thing that is to understand, and by the way, sometimes people spend a lot of time to understand this thing. It's not necessarily very trivial. So there is this one, to understand data and the level of data processing, this thing is very important. There is actually I think that might, later on I will show another slide that comes, it's called DIKW. Division or a pyramid. D is data, I is information, K is knowledge, and W is wisdom. This is another one. So you have data of many different forms, and this comes you should be familiar with. Data can be structured data, right? What is the example of structured data? Your relational database table, right? Data can be semi-structured data, right? Your XML document. Right, your tags, and then you have some stuff going on. And data can be unstructured, just English text or some little things here and there. HTML can be called, any markup language can be called semi-structured. Then you have syntactic metadata. Metadata is data about data, right? Data that describes data, data that associates some level of improved understanding about the data. So it could be like I have a file that could say what is the language, English or Russian or whatever. What is the format? What is the length of the document? When was it created? Who created it? If it's audio, what is audio bit rate? Right? So if you think about all this data, it doesn't say anything about what that data is about. It gives you things like physical stuff, right? The next is structured data, which allows you to kind of say some things have some meaning. Very minimalistic thing. For example, you say I have document H1 is a tag in HTML, right? So it tells me this is a header, right? And I could possibly say that header has more important text than some text in the fourth paragraph of that document, potentially, right? Likely, right? So document structure like DTDs or XSL, or you might even cluster the data using statistical algorithms. And you can do similarity processing, this thing being similar to this. Not the same, but similar in what occurs is the same. Those things are all examples of structural metadata. Then comes semantic metadata. Now we are talking about what does that data mean? I don't care how it is represented. I mean, what does it mean to my brain, to my understanding? So then, for example, an example would be, and this is very partial, thing. When I say ontology driven metadata, meaning I have defined some concepts in the ontology. These are concepts of interest to me in a particular domain, for a particular application. In this case, my example is some example of radiology. So then I would say region, this is a concept in the ontology. And I would say that this particular image has the, is about upper abdomen, and the and there is a organ as a concept in the ontology, and they say the particular organ, there is one organ in here, it's called liver, and I label that particular organ in that whole image, I label it as liver, right? So the interpretation of the liver is coming from the ontology, right? Because the term, What does a region mean? What does an organ mean? It's not just this text that you say. Right now, when you are reading this term organ, you are appealing to your knowledge about what is an organ. You learned what an organ is, a human organ is. But in the ontology, it will be defined through a structure, a representation, to some level. And only to a partial level. It can never define as completely, because your human brain can come up with a different interpretation or enhance the interpretation. And there's no way to document every little bit of detail. That's why we have legal cases, right? Because all the situations are not foreseen, can't be spelled out, right? Or have different potential interpretation, pathological structure. So in this particular radiological image, there is abscess, an abscess located in liver. Right? So a radiologist in this case is using this ontology to write this metadata, which or annotate the data. Data is image, right? And then you represent knowledge where you will have concepts like anatomy. That's how you got this kind of stuff. Anatomy as a region. Diagnostics. That is, you're using this radiology thing for diagnostics, and there will be some concept, thing that will define what, there will be specific medical term for an abscess in liver, and actually what part of the liver. Right? So there's some coding scheme, many other things where the interface comes. So the point here is that at the bottom of the pyramid, you have form, shallow form of semantics. And then you go for deeper semantics. And basically, semantics for you use semantics for deeper understanding, meaningful analysis, actionable information. When you want machine to do more for you, you need semantics. And there is again, if you are curious, you know, you want to learn more about this, often my slides will have these links. So you click on the link and you'll get a whole paper that describes this in a lot of more details, right? Number three, reasoning or computation. What do you do with it? The first is knowledge. Second is annotating the data. Your data, you annotated that. Now what? That doesn't do any good to anybody. People want to do something with it. So they want to either search, they want to integrate data from multiple sources, they want to answer a complex query. Query would have done, give me all the images that shows abscess in the left part of the liver or something like that, right? So or you can ask, that will be a query, but you can ask questions also. You can find connections and analysis, for example, in the context of Patriot Law. When you go to a bank and open an account, the bank is required you to do what is called as know your customer. And so it is required to test, do certain level of checking to say that do you have any known relationship with any of the bad entities, like any of the organizations known for money laundering, anybody of the organizations known for terrorism, that is laws, any of the organizations that have been sanctioned on the sanction list, like US has sanctioned list to Russia, you know, sanctions on Russia as an example, or Iran, right? So you have these things, and they are supposed to check. The reason I know is that the technology that the company has started in 1999 built is deployed at majority of world's big bank in to do precisely that. Know your customer. Finding, and it uses semantic technologies, finding patterns, mining, hypothesis validation. So these are all various forms of processing information, more intelligent processing information, okay, for which semantics can be used. So these are 1, 2, and 3 of semantic web. Now, from a technological perspective, you know, you have to build software, right? You have to build things that work. For that, there is an organization, and we discussed that World Wide Web, right? That was founded by Tim Berners-Lee. And the World Wide Web Consortium worked quite a bit on completing or creating these standards for both the web and the semantic web. So these are the there are standards for how do you specify URI, right? Does everybody know what is URI? Yes. Everybody. I'll be happy to describe, right? It's very important concept. Very important concept, right? Unique. That's very, you know, identification, right? So this is resource identifier. So the point here is that it has a very interesting implication. Suppose I have that URI, meaning there's only one object that has that as an identification. Now we can ask the question, do you agree that this thing is exactly the same as that thing? That makes it, you know, to in the context of formulating question for are the two things similar, having that concrete ID is very important. It's just a basis from where you can start. Anyway, there are things for XML. This is not considered to be part of semantic web, that's part of the basic web. But then what you see here are the parts that are technologies or standards basically, and then corresponding technologies for semantic web. So the first and the foremost is RDF, right? So what does RDF stand for? I'm fond of saying that relationship is at the heart of semantics and semantic web. Relationship is the heart of semantics. So whenever you talk about anything, the understanding about that thing or the meaning associated with that thing comes by what it is associated with. So suppose you can think of a really me as an object, right? Really, it means to you, you know, what do I mean to you? It is whatever relationship you're interested in, either an instructor or an advisor or a professor or a guy working at Rice State or whatever it is, those are the things that will help you define to you what this thing means to you, right? So it is not, there is no semantic meaning by itself in Amit Sheth. There is no semantic. It is how you associate that with different things in the world where that ultimately reveal the you know what it means, right? So before RDF is basically modeled for semantic data, right? And so before that there are many models, right? You have RDB, relational database, a relational model, right? Compared to all those models, and you have XML, that's also been there. Why RDF is so important, why it is powerful, is because it has a relationship as a first class object. Think about it, a relational database has tables, and you have columns, and you have to have foreign key or some other forms to link the things, and you link them by values. That's not powerful enough. So everything in semantic web, generally speaking, not everything in the semantic web as per the standards is seen as triple, a subject, predicate, object, or entity, relationship, entity. Entity one, relationship, entity two, right? And that relationship is very thin, it connects them. There's another way of thinking about it. That if you think of RDF, there are a couple of ways to look at their bodies. One is a triple and database of triple, like in SUC database of tuples in relational databases. But other is as a graph, because see you have entity one connected to through a predicate connected to another entity two, right? And then entity two is connected to something else in there. So all that creates basically a graph, right? So compared to other models of representation, graph is a more powerful model of representation. So fundamentally, if you look at even a data structure perspective, right? If you go back to your, you know, some of you might have done data structure a few years ago, some of you may have done recently. If you go back fundamentally to data structure, or if you think about your algorithm courses, if you've done algorithm courses, majority of algorithms involving, major of the issues involving graph are complex. All path algorithm is incomplete, right? Non-tractable algorithms, most of the algorithms, right, for the graph. And you know there are certain trade-offs in the life, like you must have learned in your data structure course, space and time trade-off, right? Similarly, there is always trade-off between expressive power and need for computation or computational complexity. More the expressive representation is, more the effort it will take to compute, right, things. But the point here is then, so there are this trade-off, and I have my own views along those trade-offs. My argument would be that it is true that with the expressiveness, computational complexity go high, so people tend to dumb down the expressive power. Whenever you dumb down the expressive power, you keep things out of the representation that is in the mind of the programmer. So my philosophy is that you need whatever expressive power you need. And if it is more expressive power, that's what you need, even if it comes at the cost of computation, because ultimately for computation, it's all computing power. Of course, some algorithm can be you know, so complex to process that you may never get an answer. So obviously you have to be watch out, you have to watch out for those things. Then there is RDF schema, there is a Kodi language, Sparkle, there is a web ontology language and called OWL, and there is a way to specify rule. Now, and we'll come to some of these as we go about. My tendency is to primarily focus on this RDF and Sparkle, or RDF, RDF and Sparkle. We may do very little in this class, unless you are, it's part of your project, on the OWL and the RDF. Because I'm more interested in the practical aspect part of the semantic web, the part that most of the world uses to learn more today, rather than the part that is written mostly in the papers and you know things of that nature. So you know, you have web of linked data, that is semantic web. The formal representation improves machine understanding of the data. And of course, you have common models of domain using formal language ontologies, and typically OWL or RDFS also is used for that. Okay. This was a presentation that a gentleman named William Rue, Will Rue, gave. At that time, he was at GE, and now he's at Cisco. He's a general manager. One of the top executives at this company, at Cisco right now. And I think this slide was probably 2006. So he talked about the semantic web as XML, RDF, and ontology. Oops, oh, it doesn't build. This slide is supposed to build. So it has these things like issues by authority, self-describing, easy to understand, can be structured. Well, sorry. Now, RDF, just an introduction. So once I'm done with this presentation, Vin, one of my PhD students who is very good at this, will be giving us a talk on RDF. So what the philosophy, you know, the idea of this class is that you're going to go in a parallel stream. On one stream, we are going to talk about conceptual stuff, we are talking about what is happening in the world, we are talking about technologies and applications and what is Google doing and what is Microsoft doing and what is Apple doing and all those things we will talk about as the things goes. And if you have gone through you know the community page, you will see a lot of discussion of those kinds, right? And so you'll see, on the other track, we will go down on the nitty gritty of the things. So that is the case with RDF. And on the third track, all of you need to start thinking about a project, because as you know, the philosophy here is that you're going to ultimately learn anything by doing anything. So yes, on one hand, I can give you a lot of big ideas or all the things the sages have said, but I want you, you know, thing that you're going to remember the most and will be most helpful to you once you're done with the class is ultimately translating all those big ideas into you know, something that is very visceral for you, something that is very tangible for you, right? So that is the project. Now the interesting thing is that you need to start thinking about project now, and we don't have too much time, so I need to come up with a strategy of how do we start thinking of the project. But one way, and I mentioned that, I don't know if I mentioned that in the last class, but there are two, three ways that you can come up with the project. One is that you just have an idea of your own and you think that semantics is useful, and you just discuss with me that, hey, here's an idea, would it be an appropriate project for the class? It could be something because you're working and you think that you could create a prototype that you can show it to your boss and say, hey, I took this class and I know the semantic web is very useful for us. Other could be that, you know, that Noesis, the center, you know, we are a very strong group of people we ranked among top 10 in the world in terms of World Wide Web, impacting World Wide Web, publication impact on 10-year basis, which is quite a story for us, not being the top 10 school as such. And so then we have a lot of projects going on, a lot of exciting projects going on, right? So one, just to give you a sense, if you go to here is a quick summary of the projects. In fact, many of our projects are large team projects, multidisciplinary projects. All our projects have real customers, practically, real users. And most of them are real applications. Most of them actually get deployed and actually used. For example, this project is acute decompensated heart failure. Patients that have heart disease, that had surgery, they're released from the hospital. We are trying to reduce their readmission rates, coming back to the hospital rates. So we use sensors and we use mobile phones and we use mobile phone as ontology and reasoning system and everything that the semantic web is about. And so that intelligent software. And we have IRB done. IRB is called Institutional Review Board, and we have permission to give this to the real patients. So this is being given to these real patients at Ohio State University's Medical School, University College, right? The same kind of thing is being done for asthma. Same kind of thing is being used for GI patients. And then we are starting to work on that for patients with dementia, right? So the sensors are different and so on and so forth. But this is an example of a project which has, in my view, everything. It has research, it has a lot of complex technological things. It has real latest technology of mHealth, dHealth, mobile health, digital health, sensors, all kinds of stuff. It has Android application, it has GUI building, you know, all kind of stuff, and all the way to actual patients and, you know, getting data from patients and reviewing the data with the doctor and saying how can I improve the applications and all that kind of stuff. Right? Similarly, we have a project with the president of has announced as Materials Genome Initiative. So it's about advanced material. And so we develop ontologies there, we have complex modeling of our material science, and we have companies like GE and Pratt & Whitney and all those things, and people who develop new materials, and they are interacting with each other, and so we're creating, you know, semantic interoperability for that. Then we have, this project involves social media for emergency coordination, all that. This project and its outcome are used with the real, companies. Real crisis. So there were cases where Google crisis map. Google has this thing. When there are crises, they give up this page for the crisis. In a couple of them, they use the data that, you know, our group created here and coordinated creation of. And now we are working on a major project with the United Nations on gender-based violence. Very important topic, very crucial topic. So a lot of things going on. So we talk to, we have meetings with the United Nations, we have meeting with local disaster response people in Dayton, we are meeting with, yesterday we had a call with a doctor who did coordination for medical issues during Haiti, and she spent a lot of time there at that time doing that. So we work with the real people with this kind of stuff. So there are a whole series of projects. Here we have started a project as a follow-on to this project, which studies social media posts for use of cannabis and synthetic drugs that people use. And we'll be studying that correlation between policies of Oregon and Colorado and the use of these drugs and such. So that involve, and so they involve machine learning, they involve natural language processing, text processing, they involve graphical design, they involve application in design, mobile phone, all kinds of stuff, right? So these are all real data. We process thousands and millions of posts coming on Twitter, and there are more when this is not even complete list yet. So I think that is what I want to talk about. I think that, let me see what we have. Oh, we are on slide 16 of 76, so we have a lot more to go. Okay, I'll let you know, we will continue with this presentation, probably won't take more than one presentation to complete this, or we may just shift over to RDF in the next class. Okay, thank you. All right, any questions at this point, any things?